Welcome to today's Environmental Law Update. I'm Ellie Kemeter with Foley and Lardner, and I'm pleased to welcome you to today's program, the Clean Power Plan and Other Significant New Clean Air Act Developments. Before I turn the presentation over to our speakers, I'd like to go over a few housekeeping items. First, we encourage you to submit written questions during the program. Please type your question into the Q&A widget open on the left-hand side of your screen. We will respond to written questions at the end of the program, time permitting. If you experience technical difficulties during the presentation, please visit the webcast help guide by clicking the help widget below the presentation window. Foley will apply for CLE credit after the web conference. If you did not supply your CLE information upon registration, please send an email to Ellie Kemeter at ekemeter@foley.com. To be eligible for CLE, you will need to log into the ON24 session and answer a polling question during the program. Please note, certificates of attendance will be distributed to eligible participants approximately 8 weeks after the web conference via email. As a final note, those seeking Kansas, New York, and New Jersey CLE credits are required to complete the attorney affirmation form in addition to the polling question that will appear during the program. A code will be announced during the presentation. Please email the form and the code to Ellie Kemeter immediately following the program. And now I would like to turn the presentation over to Dick Stoll, who will introduce today's speakers and program.
Okay, thanks, Ellie. It's been a really busy summer for EPA and for the courts. And three of the most recent significant developments are really quite recent. Today we're going to cover the Clean Power Plan, which just came out on August 3rd in final form. It's not even in the Federal Register yet. We're going to cover the State of Michigan Supreme Court case on the match rule, which was at the end of June. And we're going to cover the D.C. Circuit's decision on the cross-state rule, which just came out at the end of July. A couple of common themes before we get going here is that if I see that some people are from electric utilities and some people are not. I think if you're not, you still ought to listen a lot if you're interested in these issues. All these rules do regulate electric utilities directly, but the impacts of these decisions and the impact of these rules go way beyond electric utilities, as I think you'll understand if you don't already know. And also, the common theme is here, we're going to show that how EPA rules and the courts are always going back and forth on each other. Judicial review is such a key part of all EPA actions these days. So what we're going to do is Brian Potts is going to cover the Clean Power Plan. I guess we got this out of order because I'm going to be last. I'm going to cover the cross-state stuff, and Mark Temke is going to cover the MAT stuff and the Supreme Court case. So let's start out with Brian Potts and the Clean Power Plan.
Thanks, Dick. So I'm assuming everyone on the call has read all 1,560 pages of the Clean Power Plan. So if you have technical questions regarding any of that language, please feel free to email them to me as we go along. I'm hoping to have some dialogue here. I mean, ultimately, this Clean Power Plan and the entire webinar is for you all. So there is a way to email questions, and please do that as we go along or certainly at the end. We'll leave some time. So the Clean Power Plan and Friends, we're not going to talk too much about the Friends, the Federal Implementation Plan, and the New Source Performance Standard for new plants. But we'll dabble a little bit with them, but you could have an entire webinar just on those rules by themselves. And I think everyone is primarily focused on the Clean Power Plan itself. So the plan is finally here, and forget what you knew about the plan. This is a new rule. Pretty much everything is different. It's easier to say what's the same than what's different. I haven't even tried to compile it. I've seen a few folks compile long lists of the differences. But it's still called the Clean Power Plan. It's based on the same Clean Air Act section, 111D. It regulates CO2 from existing power plants. It uses building blocks, although every building block is different. And it does give states flexibility in complying and fairly flexible as far as what the compliance options are. Other than that, everything is different. So all the time you spent analyzing the proposed rule is probably not going to be of much use to you now. So, with that said, what are the important dates in the Clean Power Plan? Well, initial state implementation plans are due a year and 2 weeks from now. But extensions are available to 2016. The extensions are much more broadly available than they were in the proposal. So I would imagine most states are going to ask for an extension. I will talk about at least one incentive EPA gave to finalize your plan sooner in the rule. But otherwise, I think in general, I would look for most states to not have their plan finalized until 2017 or 2018. But they still need to submit something September 6, 2016. The start date, as everyone knows, was moved back to 2022 from 2020. But so on paper, it looks like that was a good thing for industry. But in practice, it's not clear what that means. And the reason is because EPA created what I'm calling a mini SIP. And that is when you submit your state implementation plan, EPA said it must also include descriptions of the measures the states are going to take in the period between 2018 and basically 2018 and 2022 to show that the state will actually meet whatever the limits are in 2022 and going forward. So what actions is the state going to take in that interim period? It's unclear what that means and how strict EPA will be about that, but practically I think that's going to drive some earlier compliance, maybe earlier renewable installations, et cetera. So the question everyone's asking is, okay, we've got this 1,500-page rule on EPA's website, but for those administrative law gurus, they know that until it hits the Federal Register, you can't generally challenge the rule. And that's the triggering date for lawsuits and for a lot of other things. And so when is this going to hit the Federal Register? Well, no one knows. I haven't heard anything in the press or seen anything in the press about that. But generally, it takes a couple months with a rule like this, so 2 to 3 months. because it's the triggering date for lawsuits, you know, a lot of times parties challenging EPA rules don't want to be the first to file in the D.C. Circuit because they don't want their name on the heading of the case. But in this instance, because there's so many political, it's such a political issue, I think there's probably going to be a race to the courthouse to try to get your name as the case name. You know, so for some of the states that are particularly opposed to it, they may be camping out in front of the D.C. Circuit for the next couple months. and at least a couple folks have speculated about whether EPA will wait and drag its feet on putting it in the Federal Register until possibly even as late as after December, which is when the international climate negotiations take place. And so while I think that would be unusual and I would expect parties to maybe file motions in the D.C. Circuit, trying to force them to put it in the Federal Register if it took them that long, it's not outside the realm of possibility.
Hey, Brian, before we leave this slide,
sure.
I think people ought to understand how, of course, everything about this rule is extraordinary. But one thing that's really extraordinary is that EPA did not run these dates like for initial SIPs. They didn't run them from like so many months from Federal Register publication. They just went ahead and set a date. And so now every day that goes by that is not in the Federal Register, that September 6th gets closer, and people who want to seek a stay of the rule are kind of stymied unless they can come up with some theory that they can go ahead and seek a stay even before it hits the Federal Register.
Yeah, that's a great point, and they're doing that, I believe, right now, aren't they?
Yeah, I guess you're going to get to that a little bit later, but there's some interesting stuff going on in the D.C. Circuit right now as we speak.
Yeah, and so, you know, if EPA waits until December to issue or to put it in the Federal Register, that practically only gives states, you know, what is that, 6 or 7 months,
yeah,
7 or 8 months to before they have to submit their SIPs to go in there and try to get a stay. So The limits, this is where the rubber meets the road. Clean power plan's really long, but these are the numbers that ultimately matter. So again, the theme that you'll hear a lot from me and others is that this is a totally different rule, and how EPA set the limit is completely different, and even what the limits apply to is different than the original proposal. So now, for reasons I'll discuss in a little bit, EPA has set one nationwide emission rate limit for two different categories of existing power plants: fossil fuel EUSGUs, electric utility steam generating units, and stationary combustion turbines. The limits are right there: 1305 pounds of CO2 per megawatt hour by 2030 and 771 pounds of CO2 per megawatt hour by 2030 for combustion turbines. So to put that 1305 number in context, a coal plant is anywhere from 2,000 to 2,400 usually, as far as what its existing emission rate is. So obviously a coal plant isn't going to meet that 1305 limit unless they either put on carbon capture and sequestration or do some outside the fence line measures, which is what EPA is expecting them to do. So EPA set this nationwide limit, and I'll talk about how they did that in a minute, but you'll also know, and everybody's focused on the state goals that EPA set. And so in the rule, there's a specific, and this is similar to the proposal, there's a specific goal, rate goal and mass-based goal, which EPA set for each state. And so, but practically all EPA did to set those state goals is take the nationwide emission rates that they calculated and apply them to the generation that was occurring in the state in 2012. So that's a lot different than what they did in the proposal, where they essentially set state limits. In this case, they're setting one nationwide limit and then translating that into what it should look like in each state. So which states are the biggest losers under the EPA's new formula? Well, basically because of the fact that EPA set a nationwide limit and then just applied it to the 2012 generation, the states that had the highest emission rates in 2012 were the biggest losers between the proposal and the proposed rule and the final rule. And EPA recognizes this fact. They basically, coal-heavy states took the biggest hit between the proposed and final rule, and the states that had the lowest emission rates in 2012 took the smallest hit and got the best deal. EPA says this throughout the rule, so there's really no dispute about it. And I'll tee it up for Dick, but and Dick is probably the better one to talk about this, but often parties challenge rules based on too much changing between the proposed rule and the final rule. And I don't know, Dick, do you want to just mention that process?
Yeah,
issues around that?
This is unique to the Clean Air Act, by the way. Don't have to worry about this in RCRA or the Clean Water Act, but in the Clean Air Act, there's a Section 307 something or other that basically says if there's something that you could not have commented on but you want to litigate on, you're supposed to file a petition for reconsideration with EPA first. What the problem that people have had recently, and I'll just go over this real quickly, and this has come up in the cross-state stuff, I can talk about it when we get to that, is that once you file one of these petitions for reconsideration, the litigation on that issue just sort of waits while EPA undertakes the petition for reconsideration. And unfortunately, EPA takes years to do that. So you're sort of stymied sometimes. So frankly, I hope on some of this, that process doesn't work to stop judicial review of some of these key issues, as it has in some other D.C. Circuit cases lately. But so I hope people are careful about that and don't go overboard on these petitions for reconsideration, because that may actually stop judicial review for a year or two.
Yeah, that's a good point. And actually just noticed we had a question that back when I was talking about the SIPs, I said the extension date, I think I said extension to 2016, but The extension would obviously be to 2018, so they get a couple more years. So thanks, Dick. And keep the questions coming, or corrections, as they may be. So the compliance timeline, the final rates have to be met by 2030. There are now interim rates from 2022 to 2029, and I mentioned the mini-SIP process before 2022. The interim rate steps are broken out, I believe, in three-year periods. And so essentially there's different rates for each period of time, and they ramp down to the final rate that I showed you before. So how is compliance measured? Well, the EPA has changed that from before. In the proposed rule, there was a lot of talk about states meeting their limits and how states were going to do that or were going to meet the rate that was set. And I think EPA recognized that, and for legal reasons, which I'll touch on later, they basically changed it to be much more focused on sources meeting the limits. So EPA basically says, here's the limit that we set, the 1300 limit. Sources, you have to meet that. And states, you just have to ensure that the sources meet that. And that's actually how EPA usually does these rules, and I think is at least that component of it somewhat more defensible than the issues before, or than how they were doing it before.
And Brian, to get picky, are they saying that the sources have to meet it, or that the sources, owners and operators, have to meet it?
Well, it's funny. There's a statement that I sort of poke fun of EPA at. The EPA has said EGUs have to meet it, and EGUs can go out and buy renewable power. But obviously a power plant can't go out and buy renewable power. They mean the owners and operators of EGUs. But ultimately, yeah, the owners or operators of the plant have to, or the unit in particular, have to meet that limit. And the way they do that is, according to EPA, outside the fence line measures. And I'll get into that in a little bit more detail. So if you live in any of these states or territories, you're off the hook from the Clean Power Plan. I noticed a lot of them are vacation spots, so I had to poke a little fun there. So how did EPA set its new rates? Well, the formula is incredibly complicated, and I'll try to take you through it at a high level because I think it's important to understanding the legal issues. EPA, from a basic level, used three building blocks instead of four. And each building block was calculated differently than in the proposal. You'll probably remember that the proposal had a nuclear component and an energy efficiency building block. Both of those were taken out. I think a lot of people would agree that these are fairly significant, if not drastic, changes to the way that EPA has calculated rates or calculated rates in the proposal. And so why did they do this? And a lot of the justification EPA has given in the rule is to shore up the legal vulnerabilities in the rule. And I think that was practically a mistake for them to admit that, and I'll get into the reasons for that in a minute. We did just get a question that says, I've heard that the EPA may publish in the Federal Register around Labor Day to coincide with a year before SIPs are due. Can you explain the likelihood or possibility of that happening? Well, I think it's certainly possible that they'll do that. It would make some sense. And I'd be interested if Dick has any thoughts, but that's pretty quick given the size of the rule for them to get that into the Federal Register.
Even if they weren't purposely trying to delay it, that would be fast. That would be extremely fast for something that long.
Yeah, and on the other hand, they have been extremely fast with this rulemaking process in general, so maybe they'll try to do that, but I think it is to their advantage politically and for other reasons to delay it. but we'll see what they do. So getting back to the formula, so here's how they did it. EPA divided the country into three zones this time, and in the proposal they divided the country by state, and so now they're dividing it into three zones, and again, they're setting one nationwide rate. The three zones are based on the various electric interconnection areas, so you had the Western interconnection, the Texas interconnection, and the Eastern interconnection. Sorry, this map is a little busy. It's the best one I could find that shows the interconnections. But so EPA looked at what the rate would be in each one of those interconnections after applying what it decided was the best system of emission reduction, and then took the least stringent rate of the three interconnections for each year from 2022 to 2030. So that's the sort of summary of what they did. The best system of emission reduction is still based on the EPA's, and I say tortured interpretation because I think this is their biggest legal vulnerability, in that they're interpreting system to mean the electric system and not be applicable to a specific plant. So that's how they get the outside defense line reductions. They're still doing that. They set the BSER for each region. Then, as I said, the EPA picked the highest rate or the least stringent, and the reason is to provide some headroom, they said. And so why did the EPA switch to this nationwide approach? Well, they think it helps them in the legal question of whether of what a system is. So best system of emission reduction, before they were looking at the electric system in each state. But there is a practical argument that electric systems are regional. And so that's why they've, at least that's my, and I think they say this in the rule, that's why they've changed to looking at three regions rather than each state. Frankly, I don't think that helps them at all with the legal argument, because whether it's a state system or a regional system, that's a lot different than an inside the fence line reduction, which is how they've always done it. But that's their rationale. So next, the EPA set the baseline for the three regions, and they used 2012 data. So that is the same. That's another list of something that's the same. They stuck with 2012 data. And they essentially averaged the emission rates of the affected units across the region. And as I talked about why they switched to using interconnects rather than state boundaries, it's more of a system, and they think it will help them in court. I disagree with that. So building block one, if you remember, building block one before was a 6% cut across the board for all coal plants in a state. Now EPA has listened to some comments that said 6% is too much, what EPA did was an analysis of each of the interconnect regions to see what they thought, what types of efficiency projects could happen at the plant, at the coal plants, and they came up with these three different numbers for the different interconnects, 4.2, 2.1, and 2.3. And building block one essentially takes the average rate in from 2012 in the interconnect regions and just slices off that amount for coal plants, which just assumes essentially that coal plants are installing technology that can get them that much better. I think this is somewhat more defensible. It's definitely more defensible than the proposal on building block one. Obviously, it gets them less than it did before because they did a 6% across the board cut. So to the extent that EPA loses in court on the other two building blocks and building block one is left, they've, you know, hurt themselves in the amount of reductions, but this one is by far the most defensible of the building blocks. So new building block two, formerly known as building block three, EPA actually still calls it building block three, but in the analysis, the way EPA calculates the rate, it actually does the renewable energy part second. So what they do in this building block is they use a seven-step formula to essentially offset coal and gas generation with new renewable energy capacity. And the way they came up with the amount of new renewable energy capacity that would be installed, again, in each of the three regions is they looked at how much had been installed over the last 5 years and what were the annual average increases and the maximum annual increases for each type of renewable energy. So, you know, how much solar was installed between 2012 and 2013 in, you know, the Texas region. And they then applied the annual average increase in the first 2 years because they said, you know, they want to be more reasonable as far as the earlier years, and then they applied the maximum annual, so the highest annual increase of the last 5 years they applied in 2024 and 2030 for each type of technology in each region, and then they got that number, the total number of new renewable energy generation for each region, and they assume that would offset coal and gas in each generation, so that lowers the overall rate for each region. And then building block three was formerly known as building block two. So the reason they switched these two building blocks is EPA wanted to have the redispatch. So building block, what I'm calling three and EPA calls building block two, is redispatching natural gas combined cycle plants or dispatching them more so they operate more to offset coal use. And before that was building block two, now it's building block three, and the reason is that EPA wanted to put the renewable energy in first so that when they redispatched the natural gas, they were going from the lower coal rate that had already been offset by renewable generation. In any event, they went from a 70, so in the proposal they said, we'll run all the natural gas plants 70% of the time, and that's feasible, and that will offset coal and oil and coal generation. Now they want to ramp it up to 75%. And they do. I will say one big difference between the proposal and the final rule is, I think in the proposal they just assumed all these gas plants would run at 70% by 2020, and now you're talking about ramping it up such that they get to the 75%. It's sometime between 2022 and 2027. It depends on which region you're in. But by 2027, all the regions are up at 75%. So there were some reliability concerns associated with dispatching those plants that quickly by 2020 and upping their utilization rate. So that's one thing EPA gave back to industry, is pushing that back a little bit. Looks like we have some questions here. So never mind. So again, the EPA used these three building blocks to set the nationwide rate. And as I mentioned, once they used the three building blocks, they got a rate for each region, and you can look them up there in the data. And then essentially they took the least stringent rate of the three regions, and that's the national rate for each year until they get to 2030. And they then converted those into state rates. So again, an EGU itself can't meet a 1300 limit. So EPA says, well, they can go out and buy renewable energy, or they can even pay someone else to operate their natural gas plant to offset their usage. And that's how they would meet the limit. So what are the compliance options? First of all, it's possible, although I think unlikely, that states could just say, okay, affected units, here's your limit, go meet it. And obviously that would be incredibly onerous for and more expensive as a compliance option, but you know, they could as part of that allow the you know, coal plant owner, for example, to prove that they bought more renewable energy or paid someone to operate their gas plant and created what are called emission rate credits that would offset their generation. I think that one's pretty unlikely because it's so expensive. I'd say the way that EPA's done this is pretty much created huge incentives to do some sort of trading program. It's clearly going to be the most cost effective. So another way they could that a state could do it is just say to each utility, you're responsible for your fleet. Your fleet has to meet this average, and you know, and go meet it. And then, of course, you could do statewide or regional trading, which, again, is probably the most economic. EPA did list some of the options for emission rate credits, which I kind of look at as offsets. Running natural gas combined cycle plants more, building new renewable energy capacity. You are allowed to still use energy efficiency reductions to earn emission rate credits, even though it wasn't part of the calculation, you can, to come up with a rate, you can still use them to comply with it. And then they listed, you know, distributed generation or solar distributed generation, offshore wind, CHP, WPH, or WHP, and transmission and distribution improvements as other options.
Brian, this is Mark Timke. I would note that at least in some states that are rich in renewable resources, when asked whether or not they would engage in multi-state trading, that their position is they will not, that they would keep all of their renewable credits within their existing statewide fleet systems and operate that way. Iowa is an example of that.
Yeah, and there's going to be interesting turf wars between the states. Obviously, some states are going to have advantages over others, and I think practically regional trading, except for maybe the regions that are already set up, is going to be politically difficult because the costs are going to be different.
Yeah, and as long as we're talking about what states will do or what they won't do, we might as well make the point that quite a few states have said they're not going to do anything in response to this plan.
Right,
They're not even going to submit a SIP.
Yeah, I mean, some states are not going to submit a SIP. Some states are going to submit a SIP and just do their own thing, and then some might try to do a regional approach, but I would think that's probably going to be limited to Reggie and maybe the western states. But, again, it's incredibly – it's going to be a lot of negotiating to be able to put a regional program together. So who asked for trading? I thought this was interesting. In a footnote in the rule, EPA listed the states that actually, in their comments, asked for trading and listed these states, and I thought it was interesting. Some of those states are opposed to the Clean Power Plan. So how much does each building block cost? Well, according to EPA, building block one is $23 per ton removed. Building block two, the natural gas combined cycle, which is EPA's name for it, is $24 a ton. And building block three, renewable energy, is $37 a ton. So that's interesting because, you know, the states that have to do a lot of renewable energy to meet the plan or will end up doing a lot of renewable energy might end up having to spend more to comply than those that have natural gas plants already around. And these numbers differ from the numbers that EPA originally put out. So there's been a lot of confusion both when the proposed rule came out and then I've still seen it about how new natural gas combined cycle plants are treated under the rule. New natural gas combined cycle are not affected units under the Clean Power Plan. So that means they were not included in the rate calculation that I talked about, the three building blocks. And so the nationwide rate that was set did not take into account offsetting generation by building new natural gas combined cycle. So that means practically if you're going to build a new natural gas combined cycle, the only way they can really help you with compliance, and this is certainly going to happen, is by offsetting higher emitting units. So if you build a new natural gas plant and that gets dispatched more and coal gets dispatched less, obviously the reduced emissions from coal help you meet it. But EPA had talked about including them in the rate calculation and as an affected unit, but they decided not to do that. Now, EPA does say that the SIP can include them. So, for example, if you did a trading program to comply, you could have maybe a new unit set aside or something, which has been done before for allowance trading programs, where new units would get allowances and participate. But practically, the question is whether EPA is going to let that affect the affected unit compliance, and my guess is probably not. So practically, I'm not sure there's that much advantage to doing that, because you could just leave the new natural gas out, and then they don't have to comply at all and deal with it. New natural gas are obviously covered under the new NSPS standard, though, that EPA put out, so they're not unregulated. So the mini SIP, I talked about it a little bit earlier. The EPA says that each SIP submittal must, quote, include a timeline with all of the programmatic milestone steps the state will take between the time of the state plan submittal in the year 2022 to ensure that the plan is effective as of 2022. And early in 2021, they will have to submit a progress report showing that they've done those things. Now, again, it's not clear what that means, what EPA is going to do to enforce that, et cetera, but it is interesting. So while everyone says the Clean Power Plan is going to start in 2022, EPA is clearly going to be trying to exert some authority to have the reduction start sooner than that. They also created this optional program called the CEIP, where basically you can get credits for projects that can be used after 2022, even though the project was put in place earlier than that. And there's a matching program from EPA. Basically, you can do it for new renewables. I think the years are starting in 2019. It's either 2019 or 2020, I can't remember, and energy efficiency projects in low-income communities. You actually get more for the energy efficiency projects. Now, the projects have to happen after the SIP is after the final SIP is submitted, so there's a little bit of an incentive there for states to do their SIP sooner, and that they will then have the ability to maybe get these CEIP credits before everyone else, because the program is capped at 300 million tons of CO2. So is this is the Clean Power Plan legal? Well, we did a poll of the law student and I did a poll of the as to the proposed rule of a little more than 130 environmental lawyers and law professors from around the country. The poll was done anonymously. The legal issues are still almost the same. I mean, obviously, EPA's made some changes, but the overall legal issues, which I'll mention in a second, are basically the same. And this was the demographic. Most of those who responded to our poll. So most of it was private attorneys, but there was also a large chunk of professors and then some utility, nonprofit, and government. So the results were very evenly divided. Overall, we said, do you believe the Clean Power Plan is currently written is legal? It was 59 yes and 58 no, and then 13 don't know. The interesting thing is private attorneys, by a wide margin, thought the plan or think the plan is illegal, and professors almost unanimously thought it was legal, which I find kind of humorous. So the second question, and this is still applicable because all of these issues are still there, do you think, or if you think it's illegal, why do you think it's illegal? And the reason this matters now is A, B, C, and D and E are all still there, essentially the legal arguments. So the building block 4 is gone, so you don't need to look at F. But the entire Clean Power Plan is illegal because it's unconstitutional. That's an argument that Lawrence Tribe has been spearheading in the Murray Energy case, and ultimately EPA helped themselves a little bit on that one by taking the compliance obligation off of the state and putting it on the sources. But as far as the 111D versus 112 issue, which is B, a large majority of the folks that thought it was illegal think that's why. And that issue is still there, and I'll mention in a second a statement that EPA made that doesn't help them. And then building block 1, I think EPA did help itself a little bit, and you could see not a lot of folks thought that was the reason why it was illegal. And building block 2 and 3, I think, are still, especially 3, the renewables, is still the most vulnerable of all the legal issues in the plan. So how did EPA help itself? Well, within hours of releasing the 1,500-page Clean Power Plan, Harvard Law professor Jody Freeman wrote a very detailed article in Politico outlining all the changes EPA made. So obviously she had had a copy of this plan before everyone else. But she loved all the EPA's changes and said they really helped themselves. I disagree with that. I think EPA made some changes that helped them on some things but really hurt them on others. So eliminating Building Block 4 was a smart move on their part. EPA did that because they say they've never required someone to reduce consumption before, which is essentially what Building Block 4 was. And I think as you could see from the poll results, Building Block 4, 3 and 4 were the weakest. So that helps them to some extent. They delayed the start date to 2022. I think that's important in that it will help them on the stay issue to show irreparable harm. There are more flexible SIP submittal deadlines, which again will help them some on the stay issue. And as I said, they help themselves on the constitutional questions by focusing more on source compliance. So,
what may not be helping them on the stay issue, though, is their setting of a September 2016 submission date and not letting that run from the date of Federal Register publication.
that doesn't help them at all.
Yeah.
But overall, I think the irreparable harm will be harder to show, at least for utilities. I'm not sure how much difference it will make when the coal companies are coming in and saying, look, this is affecting coal markets. So going back to the whiffs and zingers, and I'll defer to Dick on the MATS rule one because I think Dick covers this, but they in the new plant rule, they kept carbon capture in place, and this is important because carbon capture and sequestration is a pretty weak argument, I think, on their part, because they have to show it's adequately demonstrated and can be installed at a reasonable cost. And it's important because if their new plant rule gets thrown out, it's very clear, and they've admitted the existing plant rule is gone as well. So I think you'll see a lot of folks challenging the new plant rule mainly as a way to challenge the existing plant rule. EPA admitted the MATS rule was in place when it issued the Clean Power Plan, which I think is a mistake. And Dick, I'll let you touch on that a little bit.
Actually,
Mark can touch
on
that.
I can talk a little bit about that.
And then the interesting thing is they did a drastic flip-flop on the 111D versus 112 issue. They had been arguing that the House and Senate amendments, which they'd argue that they conflict on the language in 111D, and the issue is whether the language in 111D allows them to regulate power plants, given that power plants have a 112 standard in place. And EPA had said, oh, there are differing House and Senate amendments, and the language conflicts, and therefore it's ambiguous, and we can decide the issue. But now they're saying, no, they don't conflict, and they've created this entirely new argument. I won't get into all the details. The page numbers are there if you want to read it, which, frankly, I don't think is very persuasive. And so they've essentially bet the entire rule on this one new argument. Also, throughout the document, they're constantly seem defensive about the use of outside defense line building blocks, and are essentially admitting that what they're doing is highly unusual, and I think is just not a very smart strategy on their part. So there's some DC circuit challenges are pending and looming. A couple questions. I'm over my time. So Murray Energy case, they lost. They came in to try to challenge the proposed rule. They lost. They've asked for rehearing. There's all kinds of motions going on in the DC circuit. A critical question is, will the same panel stay that heard the Murray Energy case? The DC circuit rules seem to imply that they would. It's important because they're three conservative appointed judges. The states have asked EPA for a stay pending the resolution of the challenges. And ultimately, in my opinion, I think the chances of a stay, they're always low, and in this case, they're probably low as well. But on the merits, I think, if they get the DC Circuit panel that they've had, they've got a pretty good shot on the merits. But en banc obviously favors EPA given the makeup of the DC Circuit court, and the Supreme Court is a wild card given its recent decisions. There might be a new Chevron standard. There's some language in their UARG decision that, sounded like a shot across the bow for EPA. At the end of the day, I think, in my opinion, building block three and two are the most vulnerable, and I'd be surprised if both of them made it through the courts. So that was a lot. Sorry to take up some of your time, Mark.
That's all right, Brian. We'll zoom through this part of it on the mats and some of the implications on environmental rulemaking, and then get to Dick's and address any questions people have. What I'll do is just give a little background to the case and the court decision, and talk a little bit about some practical considerations. Just make an observation that this webinar, we're talking about rules. We used to talk about enforcement and PSD and the activity there. I think what this reflects is really a change in the approach of the administration, of not looking at enforcement on an individual facility basis to bring about change, but EPA recognizing they get a lot bigger bang for their buck through rulemaking. Look at the number of facilities affected by the Clean Power Plan, by the MATS rule, and all the other rules that are going forward. And even if they don't win on the rule, they still have people planning to make changes in compliance with the proposed rule or with compliance schedules, and so in a way they win on that as well. Well, let's get into the MATS case and what we're looking at here. Just very quickly, a little bit of background. This deals with the hazardous air pollutants. The utilities had a deferral from the 1990 Clean Air Act, where the rest of industry was subject to the MAC standards. And the deferral applied until there was a finding by EPA that regulation of air toxics, principally mercury, from coal-fired power plants was appropriate and necessary. And those are the key words that we'll be looking at. There was a 2000 finding from the Clinton administration that it was appropriate and necessary, and that was reaffirmed in 2012. Obviously, between 2000 and 2008, there was an administration that didn't take that much to heart at times. The rule came out in 2012, finding that mercury regulation was appropriate. They looked at harm to the environment to find that, and there were controls available, and it was necessary because the Clean Air Act's other provisions didn't control mercury from power plants, and so they imposed those limits with that understanding. The legal challenge was primarily brought by a large number of states and trade groups, and I think you're finding this. You'll find it in the Clean Power Plan. You'll find it in a lot of the challenges that now states are becoming very active in rule challenges in addition to trade groups. And it's kind of an interesting development as these rules take on large effects. The narrow issue was in the question of whether cost was required to be considered in the decision to regulate power plants. Again, was cost an appropriate factor to be considered? The decision came down with EPA saying that cost must be considered, but there's some broader implications we're going to talk about with respect to how US EPA applies interpretations of administrative decisions and whether there's a new reasonableness test that's been added. As I said, the legal issue is whether the word appropriately, which seems to be a very broad and ambiguous term, could exclude cost. EPA said they could. They didn't need to look at cost factors when they looked at whether a regulation was going to be appropriate to go forward. And the short answer, as I said, the court said no. The broader implication to pay some attention to here is that historically there's been a tests of giving judicial deference to EPA interpretations of statutes, especially when there's ambiguous language in the statute. EPA is supposed to be the expert agency, and traditional tests have said that where these words are ambiguous, we'll give deference to the agency. Here, the Supreme Court disagreed and imposed a reasonableness test on the interpretation of appropriate, and that's something we hadn't seen before in administrative law, of adding on another layer of a test of reasonableness, and the question is, how far does that extend? Right now, just to give you the where we're going in the next steps before we look at some of the implications of this, and this does affect to a certain extent, the Clean Power Plan, as Brian mentioned, there's some challenges that there's a 112 MAT standard in place, and that undercuts the effect of EPA relying on the 111 provisions under the Clean Air Act. The D.C. Circuit could vacate. They could order EPA to do a fix to the record, or they could order EPA to redo the rule. EPA is seemingly consistent with their view in the Clean Power Plan that MATS is effective. They're taking the view that they will underdo a new cost review by the spring of 2016 to undertake a fix to the record, and that will then allow them to go forward and have the MATS rule upheld because now they will have considered costs in terms of what's appropriate, and presumably that consideration will say the MATS rule survives even though there are costs associated with it. There are also some issues that are coming up in some litigation. This was raised in the tri-state litigation as to whether or not the MATS rules in effect. They're trying to get a stay on that litigation to say that because EPA hasn't taken action off of the D.C. Circuit that there can't be any enforcement to basically compel compliance with the MATS rules going forward. So that may be an issue and a decision in that particular litigation that may, again, raise whether the MATS rule can be corrected in a simple cost review fix or has to be entirely redone. I think some of the practical implications of this, as I indicated, EPA is getting instead of going after, offending what they would call offending categories of business and want to force change through PSD and that type of enforcement, that they come out with these rules, and then certainly under the hazardous air rules, you get 3 years to compliance schedule with a potential fourth year being allowed. Roughly 80% of the coal-fired electric generation has already put in mercury control to meet an April 2015 deadline. So especially in the utility industry where there's a lot of planning that goes forward, a lot of activities, compliance is already put in place with the new equipment, and there have been some new source review settlements where mercury controls went in as part of the settlement, obviously anticipating that they wanted to put those in as part of the controls for mats. There are about 200 power plants out there with one-year extensions. That's the 3rd to the 4th year. And there are some issues with respect to those power plants right now, whether or not they proceed to put on the controls. What are rate commissions going to do with that for these regulated, those who are in regulated states? Are they going to get rate recovery, even though this rule is sort of in flux as to whether or not applies, doesn't apply, whether it's going to get remanded or vacated by the D.C. Circuit? So that's one of the issues that's out there. But beyond utilities, the conservative wing of the Supreme Court is the one who wrote the opinion, and Justice Scalia, in his usual concise style, took some real shots at the agency. But this future deference to EPA in terms of its interpretations of ambiguous words is open to question. And do we have a new reasonableness standard that layers on top of this, that the agency's action has been reasonable? How we define what is reasonable, again, is not clear. Is it a procedural approach that I simply have to go weigh costs and benefits and do a report? We've all seen that in rulemaking. And a lot of times it always comes out that the cost benefits as the rule goes forward. So is that all that's there? Or is there some other action consideration that needs to come into effect? Certainly we could see this reasonableness test in the Clean Power Plan, ozone, SIPs, new ozone NAAQS standards coming out, and other NAAQS revisions. I will point out one interesting one that just was pointed out in the trade press today was some litigation before the Second Circuit in New York. It involves a group of Trout Unlimited against EPA. It's a water diversion, water transfer case over a water transfer rule, and the environmental side is actually raising the reasonableness and test out of the Matt's case and saying that EPA did not consider the costs of transferring dirty water into clean water, and therefore that's a flaw in this rule, which is an interesting approach of saying that the scope of this decision, at least by certain environmental communities when they want to use it, is broader. EPA came back and through the U.S. Justice Department said, well, this case really only applies in a very narrow band of dealing with this particular utility issue, and all it requires is, quote, at least some attention to cost. So you can interpret what some attention to cost means, a couple of pieces of paper or something else. So that in a nutshell is very quick on the MATS rule, so we can get Dix in and we can finish up our talk for the day.
Okay, thanks, Mark. I'll try to do this in just a couple of minutes. We're going to talk about the D.C. Circuit's decision on July 28th on cross-state. There's a real history to the cross-state stuff, the transport rule, CARE, whatever you want to call it. We're talking about the good neighbor provision in the Clean Air Act in Section 110. Every state is supposed to have something in its plan that makes sure that it doesn't interfere, that its own state's emissions don't interfere with attainment and maintenance of the standards in neighboring states. It's called the good neighbor provision. Talk about, as I mentioned at the very beginning, talk about how really all of this EPA rulemaking is constantly getting twisted around by the courts. There's a long and sordid history of EPA trying to implement this provision. There's been cases in the D.C. Circuit in the year 2000 and 2008. The D.C. Circuit has rejected EPA's approach several times. So this, you know, EPA was back at the drawing boards again on this particular plan that they issued called the Transport Rule, the Cross-State Rule, in August of 2011. Many parties did file D.C. Circuit judicial review, surprise, and it was consolidated under the case name EME Homer. Just two basic issues that we ought to discuss real quickly here, because it did go up to the Supreme Court, and then it's come back down to the D.C. Circuit. Okay, when states are doing these plans to make sure they're not messing up the neighboring state's air quality, okay, we do have standards. We have air quality standards. Do states have to tailor their plans so they're directly going to connect to exact attainment and the maintenance in the neighboring states or not? EPA did not do it that way. EPA said, hey, we're going to have some cost-effective controls on sort of a national basis, and we're not going to worry that much about specific tailoring to assure just exact compliance with ambient standards in the neighboring states. That's the way they did it. Also, they did this new plan without giving states the first crack at source-specific emission limits. They were sort of in a hurry, and they did what they called the FIP first approach, FIP meaning federal implementation plan. This went to the D.C. Circuit, and 2-1, the D.C. Circuit rejected EPA's approaches on both of those issues. They basically said, yes, EPA, you do have to do this kind of tailoring. You just can't use this cost-effective approach because it can result in over-control. And EPA, you can't do the FIP first approach. That's not consistent with what the statute says. You've never done it that way or anything. So then the Supreme Court reverses. And the Supreme Court reversed on those two issues. They reversed the D.C. Circuit. And they say they sort of cut the baby in half on tailoring. They said EPA's cost-effective approach makes some sense. They don't have to do precise tailoring. But on the other hand, if any state can show that the result of what EPA did is actually resulting in more control than necessary in that state, they can get the rule reversed as to that state based on over-control. The Supreme Court said EPA could do the FIP first approach as long as EPA had validly disapproved state implementation plans before they did it, and there were some questions left. So they remanded this all back to the D.C. Circuit. So we get – oops, Ellie. Well, I don't know what happened there. Okay. I thought Ellie was going to give a code there. I'm sorry.
I guess just keep going.
Yeah, I'll just keep going.
Yeah.
Okay. So we have the new round of briefing. We have oral argument in the D.C. Circuit, and they have a new opinion. And they did entertain challenges on this over-control ground, and there's the states they left. There's several states who won, and you'll see them right there, and EPA is going to have to go back to the drawing boards in those states and redo the good neighbor provisions for those states. But the D.C. Circuit did uphold those SIP approvals as being – I'm sorry, the SIP disapprovals as being valid. And they also – there were several other issues kicking around in there, and they resolved all those issues in EPA's favor with a great deal of deference, at least on technical grounds. On technical scientific stuff, there were several issues raised, and you'll see an incredible degree of deference there that the D.C. Circuit gives to EPA. And it was 3-0 on that point.
I have the code.
Oh,
it's,
okay.
I guess Ellie's headset's having a hard time, but it's N is in no, R is in Roger, H, T is in toy, R is in Roger. So that's the code.
You want to do it one more time?
Sure. N R H T R.
Okay. I'm sorry. Okay, so practical effect for right now. Most power plants aren't worried that much these days about the cross-state rule because EPA's extended the deadlines in that rule, and EPA is going to have to go back to the drawing boards and redo a new rule. And you can see there what's the latest word. They're reviewing the decision. You know, you'll see the last word there in my last point. Now, there's going to be more cross-state rulemaking coming, though, okay? And people are going to watch that carefully, and especially with new ambient air quality standards coming up, there could be more stringent rules coming under cross-state. And think about it this way. Even though this has always been directed at utilities only, there's nothing in the statute that says cross-state or transport or care or whatever you want to call it has to be directed at utilities only. If Brian's Clean Power Plan is upheld, or many parts of it are upheld, and the match rule, too, there's not going to be that many power plant emissions left from coal-fired plants. So it wouldn't be that surprising to see petroleum refineries and cement kilns and other types of sources getting dragged into the next cross-state exercise. So again, who won, lost anything after all this? EPA clearly got their FIP-first approach through the Supreme Court and the D.C. Circuit. They got their cost-effectiveness approach, sort of, but they got to be careful with over-control. And they definitely got some great favorable D.C. Circuit language on deference on technical and scientific stuff. Like one good example I'll end with is on modeling. The petitioners before the D.C. Circuit were able to show the D.C. Circuit that EPA's modeling results not only were not exactly inaccurate, but they were just dead wrong. They went the wrong way sometimes. And the D.C. Circuit said, that's okay, model's a model, and we got to defer to EPA on technical and scientific grounds. So there are there any questions now that we want to address? Brian, Mark, you have any you want to address real quickly? Then we're probably going to have to sign off.
Did get one question, which I'll just mention. Someone asked whether the 300 million tons in the CEIP, the sort of early action credits, is enough incentive, and do we expect all those credits allowances to be used? And my answer is that 300 million is about, I don't know, about 5 to 10% of the U.S. emissions. So it's a pretty large chunk, and I would expect, you know, I'm not sure whether all that will be used, but given the matching, I think there's going to be a lot of incentive to use it.
Okay.
So,
well,
so
we are
that,
over time. Go
ahead. Yeah, we're over time. Do you want to sign off, Dick?
Yeah, and as usual, this will all be posted on the Foley website within a few days. And as usual, if you have any more questions, just email them to us and we'll answer them. So thank you very much for listening.